So, you know. Okay, question?
Can I come up?
Sure.
Sure. Yeah, thank you.
So, I think I mostly just wanted to ask you a couple of things. And I, throughout, while you were talking, I was writing all of these notes and really, really thinking about all of your points. And then everyone was asking all these questions, and you're right. Everyone got off topic, and the point here is, what besides from what you read in the Bible proves that God and your God is true? Because saying the Bible says this, that's a tautology. You can't believe in something because it says that
right.
It is true.
Circular reasoning, right.
So what do you have, if you're not looking at the Bible at all, what to you proves that your specific God, not the Hindu God, not the Muslim God, not God and Goddess of Wicca and that sort of thing, what tells you that your Christian God, in ever, and also in whatever sect that you believe in, or because there are, you know, hundreds of different sects of Christianity, what tells you that you and your specific sect of your specific religion is true without looking at your religious book?
Okay. First of all, I prove the Bible is true, number one. Number two, and that my book called The Proof.
So sitting back there. Everyone buy it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. But the, that's my decades of work. But the thing is that I'm going to say something that's really surprising to you, probably. First of all, I proved that the Bible is true, so I accept what it says. But, you know, my sect, I don't have a sect. My sect is science and logic and reasoning and experience. But the everybody says, there's a verse in the Bible that says, only through Jesus can you be saved. Okay, wait a minute. Let me, that's what I'm going to say that's surprising to you. I say, wait a minute. You mean Jesus? He was only on the planet for 33 years. And his ministry only lasted for 3 years. You mean he can't manifest anywhere in any way that he wants? And it says all things came through him. So therefore, I say it's really a one-on-one thing. That's what God's looking for. And the Bible even says that. It says that, it's 1 Peter, I think. It says that if a person fears God and acts uprightly, he's acceptable to God. So I'm saying Jesus could manifest anywhere he wants.
That's fine and dandy, and I think I'll move on to a different question since you've completely ignored my original question.
No. I answered it.
Wait. Or you can just give another chance. She was basically saying, just can you give me some evidence besides the Bible,
And then you pulled out stuff from the Bible saying I proved it to be true. I'm saying,
well, that's important.
Don't look.
Okay. Can I prove it? Okay.
Yeah, just give. Like
I just
that
I did it. Maybe. That was my presentation. It's a non-physical, powerful, intelligent, eternal being.
So. Is God all-powerful or not?
Yes.
So if God is all-powerful, then why does God not know the future, as you suggest, and which is completely different from most other Christians?
That's the omniscient part. Well, because it just doesn't make sense. That means we don't have free will.
Okay.
And it's important to him. This is his project.
That's true. If that's important to God, and if you're saying that God finds certain things to be important and to be good, another qualifier that I want to ask is, do you believe that God is good?
Of course.
Okay, so if God is good, and which, by the way, in part of your argument you said that, oh, well, wait, you're anthropomorphizing God. Well, if God finds certain things to be good and important, and he's jealous, and he really feels sad when we don't go his own way, isn't that also anthropomorphizing God by saying that he is also a specific being? Do you believe that God is a man? Do you believe...
He's a spirit.
Okay, so he is a spirit. Okay.
Well, I'm not going to say it. And okay. it's just traditional.
That's fine. But my point here is, isn't that in itself anthropomorphizing God?
Well, that's part of his nature, though, as revealed in the Bible.
Okay, I think I'm done.
That's why I had to prove the Bible. That's why I have proved the Bible, don't say.
I think we can go home now.
No, not yet, but think
you
when you get there.
You had your chance, and you've been dropping a bunch of different people, and so she needs to get there herself.
That's okay. Let's just have a friendly conversation. It's okay.
Yeah.
I just want to make one comment on this too. There's usually in philosophy there's some arguments for God. One of them is called the ontological argument for God, which means basically God is the greatest being you can imagine. So if you can, and the reason for this, and this is what they call the philosopher's God, and they usually say that God is all knowing because if he's not all-knowing, somebody might imagine, you know what, I think there's a greater God that's all-knowing, and now that God just beats your God. So that's why the ontological argument, which...
No, my God would trump that God.
I'm just saying...
Because of free will. It's free will is better than no free will.
Yeah. So basically, that's the ontological argument. That's a philosophical argument for God, and that's why a lot of Christians say God's all-knowing and all-powerful and all good, all this good stuff, because he has to be the best that you can imagine.
But usurping our future and our free will would not be an all-powerful and all-good God, because free will, he wants a relationship with
us. I know, those are arguments against the ontological argument. I'm just saying there's an ontological argument for God, and I agree with you, it's not a good argument, but I'm just saying that's what it is, and that's why people say it.
Okay.
So, anybody else want to ask a question that hasn't asked one yet? Anybody new? Before we go for seconds.